being made in an area like that. A couple of men have stepped forward to be leaders, and it's really just a wonderful thing to see that the fruit of that. And for me, as I get older, we were in Tennessee the end of last week, and I got to see a lot of people that we knew from back in the 70s when we were in Alabama and so forth. And I told them, man, you guys look like you're just getting old. And, of course, I look in the mirror every morning. I don't notice that. But isn't it strange? You don't notice your own situation. I'm looking at one guy says, man, you know, you used to have hair. He said, you did too. So the way that goes. But it's grand to see the work of the ministry, and we appreciate the opportunity to do those things and you. But for me, it's always good just to come home. No matter where I'm at, my heart's here and with you folks and the work of the ministry. And someone last Sunday he came into the meeting during on the coast and said, you know, Alex is supposed to start teaching Romans this morning, but he didn't do that. And there were some people mad at him about that. So no matter where I'm at, you know, you keep up with what's going on at home. And that's okay, and that's good. So praise the Lord. Joanna Dorr, that does the bookstore, is not here this morning. She broke her wrist this past week, and she's in a tremendous amount of pain. And she's not real sure what to do about it, but she's not here for that reason. I think Greg's doing the bookstore, but you want to maybe, you know, if you'd like to encourage Joanna this week, that would be a good thing. Finances are a real issue with her. She doesn't have a lot of funds and so forth to do it. Took to even to see to some of that. So we'll be, you know, interested in helping her with that. So if you'd like to be a part of that, you can be aware of that and the benevolent fund of the church, participate that way. But we'll see that she's taken care of. But I just learned that this morning. So you pray for her. You encourage her. I know it means an awful lot to her. Several years ago, she had the opportunity to move to another part of the country, and she made the choice to stay here because she didn't want to leave the fellowship of the saints. And I tell you, I talk to people all the time, and I think one of the criteria that you ought to have about where you live is you ought to have, you don't chase money in a job. Go somewhere where you can have your family in a good Bible-believing grace church. That'd be a priority in my life. It ought to be in yours. And when you order your family, and you set your family together, and you try to establish the way you're going to have your home and your family and your children raised, one of the elements, you don't just say, well, I'm going to go over there for money, and maybe there'll be a church. That's, you got that backwards. And she made some real, real good decisions that way. And because you're going to struggle in life no matter where you go. You know, finances are going to be whatever they are no matter where you go. You see somebody says, I want more zeros at the end of my paycheck. You know what happens? Murphy's Law, expenses rise to meet income. And if you can't live within the income you've got right now, you can put five more zeros at the end of it, you won't live within that one either. It's personal discipline and other things. We stopped at an antique store. My wife wanted to spend some time with me in the car. So we drove 10 hours to Chattanooga and 10 hours back Thursday and yesterday. I asked her last night, is that enough? And she says, well, she slept most of it, so. And she's asleep, and then she wake up, and she says, I turned the radio on, and she says, well, can't we talk? I said, well, you know, we could have if you hadn't been snoring, but it's too late now. She, you know, when you get in the car and the hum on the freeway, you just naturally kind of doze off. And if your companion is not, you know, a real great conversationalist, I guess you doze off anyway. But the guy was telling me about stopping at an antique store, and he said it was kind of an upscale antique store. You know, things weren't $100. They were thousands of dollars, $16,000 and $6,500 for a chair. And he kept saying, I don't want that. And the guy said, well, what period are you really looking for, you know? He said, I'm looking for the period to move about three digits to the left. And that works for me. Ephesians chapter number 1, if you will. Ephesians chapter number 1. We're down to verse number 7. And trying to work our way out of this verse, in whom we have redemption through his blood. That's, of course, talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. The forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace. That phrase at the end of that verse, according to the riches of his grace, it presents one of those little fascinating side studies in the book of Ephesians. And one of the biggest problems I'm having in us going through Ephesians is not taking all these little excursions that go around. I do that enough, but There's so many little things in Ephesians that you can take and start and study through the book, and how fascinating these little threads of thought are. And there have been about a half a dozen of them down here in the first six verses. This is one of them. Over and over in Ephesians, he uses that phrase, according to. Here's the measure. And he does it in two categories. First, if you look back at verse number 4, according as he hath chosen us. In other words, the measure has to do with the choosing, something God planned to do. And there's one whole category of these according to statements that have to do with the divine will, the purpose of God, and they focus on that. Verse 5, having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ, according to the good pleasure of his will. Verse number 9, having made known unto us the mystery of his will, according to the good pleasure which he hath purposed in himself. Come over to chapter 3, verse number 11. According to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus. Those kind of things. So there is a measure that we're to measure things by that has to do with what God's doing. Here's the measure. Here's the standard measurement. And the standard of measure that God has is this cosmic plan that he has in his Son. Everything God, when he measures what's going on, he doesn't measure it by the moment. We do that, you know. You look at life and something happens. And it's been fascinating the last couple of weeks Alex has given you a laundry list of folks in the hospital, folks that are sick, everything from little babies, the Perez little child, to Juliana, who's at the other end of life, and all in between, and things that are happening. And we measure things by the circumstances, the event. We live from event to event, and that's normal. It's not an inappropriate thing. But when you talk about when God measures things, he isn't measuring it by this event and that event and that event and that event. He doesn't live paycheck to paycheck kind of life. He says, there's this big cosmic thing going on here, and you're a part of it. You're plugged into it. And when you measure the reality of what life is about, you need to see that big plan. Because everything God's doing, there's this measure, and he wants you to grasp this big thing that he's doing in his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And the joy is that you've got a part in that. Right. You're part of something wonderful, something eternal, something that lasts forever, something that can't be done away with, something that can't be stopped. It's wonderful to be a part of it, and to know what it is, and to understand it, and to be given the privilege to say, hey, here's what life really is about. Then the other category is emphasized in verse 7, according to the riches of his grace. Now, that's not the divine plan. That's the wealth of God's grace that's going to produce the plan. I've talked to you, through the years. Grace is all that God is free to do for you through the finished work of Jesus Christ. There's this unfathomable, unending, abounding source of God's goodness and provisions that comes through the cross work of Christ. And he says he's redeemed us and forgiven us according to this wealth that he has in himself. All the things that he's provided us in his grace. If you run down to verse number 19, what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power. You see, there's the measure is the wealth of the power of the life that God has given to us in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen, brother. You got that. Real life. Chapter 3, verse 20. Now to him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power, and I love this, that worketh in us. It's not just God's power out over yonder, it's God's power right here. And you know, when I need the power of God, that's where I need it. I don't need God's power nearly as much out there running around, moving school buses and cold fronts and clouds and stuff around as I need it in here. Because I've found that the greatest enemy I have is in here. And the victory that I need is in here. And there's this power of God, this miracle-working power of God working in. We're strengthened by his might. According to his glorious power, strengthened by his Spirit in our inner man. Chapter 4, verse 7, but unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. You've been provided with grace. The grace there is not, It's not just that God's given you forgiveness and redemption and adoption and acceptance and all those things. The grace there is like the grace in chapter 3, verse number 7. When Paul says unto me, whereunto I was made a minister according to the gift of the grace of God, given unto me by the effectual working of his power, unto me who am less than the least of all saints, that is this grace given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. The grace there, Paul says, this grace is given to me is this opportunity to be the apostle of the Gentiles, the one who proclaims this wonderful message of his grace. Unsearchable riches. You don't find it in the Scripture till you come to the Apostle Paul, but now there's this message that God has for us to proclaim, and Paul says, this is a special favor given to me. And Paul says, you and I have got that same opportunity. We've got this measure, 4:7, but unto every one of us is given grace. That is that special privilege of serving according to the measure of the gift of Christ. The measure is according to what God's doing in the dispensation of grace. That's why if you don't understand what's going on today, you're never able to have what God's doing really set at liberty and work in your life. Now go back to chapter 1, verse 7. That's an interesting study, by the way. I just went through the verses with you. But you can spend some time on those verses and really appreciate and come to appreciate how the things done according to the plan of God and the things done according to the power of God. Things that are in his program, things that are in his purpose, and then things that are the wealth. There's his will and his wealth. Colossians 1:27 sort of summarizes that. You know, when we went through Colossians, I tried to say to you, and I know you don't remember all this because that was 5, 6, 7 years ago. For me, it's like I just said it yesterday, but I keep thinking, well, you know, you probably forgot. I was talking to some guys in Tennessee the other day that I knew back in the 70s. And I said, isn't it interesting? We were rehearsing and remembering things that happened when we were young, in our 20s and when we knew each other. And I said, isn't it interesting? We can remember those things like they were yesterday, and I can't remember what I had for breakfast this morning. I said, you know, you don't know. You're young. You don't know what that's like. When you get there, remember I told you, okay? And the memory of things. But Colossians 1:27, to the saints God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery. God wants you to know what is the wealth that you have in Christ. He wants you to appreciate how wealthy, how powerful what you have in Jesus Christ really is. That's God's grace to you. What is it? Christ in you, the hope of glory. Some people misunderstand that verse and say that the mystery is Christ in you, the hope. It's not the mystery. The wealth, the riches of that mystery is Christ in you, the hope of glory. He's everything. He's the sum of it all. Paul says that we preach Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery. We don't preach the mystery. We preach Jesus Christ according to the way God has him made known today. But he's the sum and the substance, for he is our hope, and he's our life. That's why he says in chapter 1, verse 7, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. Those two wonderfully measureless things, redemption, the lifting away of the burden and the captivity and the slavery of sin and being set free, and forgiveness, that joy of being of having all of the freedom permanently brought into our life. That's the positive and the negative. And they're permanent, that measureless freedom. They're free, they're permanent, they're complete, the things we never lose. We were looking at Romans 4. I want you to look back over there with me because there's something about forgiveness that I don't want to miss us. I don't want us to miss. Romans chapter 4, verse number 6. Get that in one hand and get Genesis chapter 30. Because there's something about forgiveness that digs deeply down into the details of your life, into your experience. Romans chapter 4, verse number 6. Even as David also describeth the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputeth righteousness without works. Now that's what he's talking about. If you look back at verse 5, but to verse 4, now to him that works not, him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. If you're going to work your way into God's favor, you're never going to get there because you can never pay the debt. Your work, your performance is just you trying to pay off the debt. You think you can, but you can't. But to him that works not, I can't do it, Lord, I'm bankrupt, but believes on him that justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Your faith resting exclusively in what Jesus Christ did at Calvary when he died for your sins, was buried, and was raised again for your justification, your faith simply resting in him, God counts to you for righteousness. He imputes. He writes it to your account, puts it on the ledger. It's yours. Even as David also describes the blessedness. David described that experience and the impact that experience of the man to whom God imputes righteousness without works. Now what I want you to see in that verse is David described the what? The blessedness. What did he say? Blessed, verse 7, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. That word bless there, that word is talking about the emotions that are associated with forgiveness. Happy. Woohoo! Joyful. It's, oh, I'm forgiven. No, it's, ho, ho, I'm forgiven. And I love the way it uses the word blessed, because that word blessed has a very special connotation to it. Come back with me to Genesis chapter number 30. In Genesis chapter 30, you have the account of Jacob and Rachel and Leah, and a lineage of their children. Now verse 13, Genesis 30, verse 13, and Leah said, happy am I, for the daughters will call me blessed. Why? She called his name Asher. Asher means happy. Leah is the mother of a little bouncing baby boy. And when she had that boy, she said, woo, I am happy. I'm blessed. That's what they're going to call me. Blessed, blessing, blessed is the man, is happiness, is joy associated. It's the kind of joy associated not with winning a football game. My dear wife, last night we got home. Before we got home, she's got the cell phone out checking the ball game scores. And at halftime when Alabama was up, 3 touchdowns, she was a happy girl. Now, until then, she's a little twitchy. She's moving around the seat a little bit, but when she found out they're up 20-something to 7, whoo, it's okay. The second half, they weren't doing so good, and she's upset again. See, that's the problem with happiness in a football game. It's good as long as your guys are performing, but when they don't perform so well, then where did the blessedness go? Where is the blessedness you spake of, Paul asked the Galatians? Well, the score ain't working. It's not blessedness based on performance. It's the kind of joy that you have when you have that little bouncing baby boy comes into the family and you say, wow. Jess told me this morning he's a granddad for the first time. You remember that first grandkid? I tell people all the time what George Reimer told me back years ago. I didn't believe him, didn't understand it, but I do now. He said, grandchildren are God's reward for not killing your kids. And every grandparent I know believes that. Now, you don't believe it until then. It's 50-50, maybe 60-40, I will. I kill the kids, that is. But there's a joy associated. I go to the hospital and see a little baby's born. They come home. People look at them and say, oh, aren't they beautiful? In mom and dad's eyes, there's never been a prettier baby, you know? And I've gone to the hospital many times, looked through that window and see those little scrunched up, pinched-faced little things, you know. And you say, who could love something look like that? And there's Daddy standing there, boy. Oh, that's my boy. That's my girl. That's my baby. And you know what I'm talking about. There's a joy. It's not superficial. It's down in your soul. There's an emotion associated with forgiveness that reaches down into your inner being and produces joy unspeakable and full of glory. A couple of years ago, my oldest grandson, Ricky, and I had opportunity to attend a rather large church on a weekday meeting, weekday evening, and they were having a prayer meeting. And he and I were doing some things, and there the meeting was, and we had some time. I said, let's go in. Maybe they'll have a Bible study or something. We can just, you know, see how other people do things. And so he's 15 years old at the time. So we went into the prayer meeting, and, oh, there was a big crowd of people, 800,000 people, and they had a big choir. They were singing and juking and carrying on. And we're sitting there watching, and we slipped in, sat in the pew there in the seats. And they started. They'd sing a while, and then they'd stop and have somebody come up and give a testimony about what some ministry that they were supporting, and then they would go to prayer, and they'd have a 10 or 15-minute prayer meeting with people walking around praying, doing all kinds of stuff. Then they'd sing a few more songs, and then they'd get another guy up there. And this went on for about an hour and a half. And so finally, we had decided to leave, so we're leaving. And now my grandson had never been in a situation like that, and I'm wondering what he's thinking. And so as we're leaving, we go over and get the elevator, go down. I said, Ricky, got any idea what they were doing? He said, no, I don't know what that was. I said, they were enjoying their religion, because that's what they were doing, having a hootenanny. He went down, we went down, and I said, do you guys do that out there at your church? Southwest Bible Church, Mason. He said, no, sir. I said, we don't do that at Shorewood either. He said, okay. I said, you know why? He said, because we don't have any religion. I said, exactly. That's exactly what it is. We don't have religion. Listen, Christianity is not a religion. Somebody says, what religion are you a part of? Don't say Christian. Say, I'm a part of the family of God. I don't have a religion. The word religion, ligio, is where it comes from. And that's, you hear the word ligament in that word? To bind. A ligament is, you have a joint, and the ligaments are the muscles that hold that joint together. Makes the joints. It's the joints and bands in the terminology of Ephesians 4. Religion is designed to join you back to God. Read, do it again. Put you back to God. But listen, the only way you can get joined back to God is not by what you do. It's in what Jesus did. It's not in who you are in yourself. It's in who God makes you in His Son. And all of the religion out here, the doing, the Bible says that pure religion and undefiled is this, to honor the Father, I'll take care of the widow and the fatherless and the stranger in the gate. Works, performing, doing things. Pure religion is not jumping around hooting and hollering in a prayer meeting. Pure religion is going out here and doing the good works that the Word of God tells people to do for the poor and the needy and that kind of thing. So if you're going to trust religion to get you to heaven, you know what you're going to have to do? Well, you're going to have to perform some things. And that's the problem. When you start performing things, what happens to your performance? It doesn't work. It's okay to help people, but wait a minute, if I've got to sell my Lexus to do it, I'm real sure about that. Well, that's what Jesus told them. Sell what you have and give it to the poor. There's a guy that he told that to, and he went away sad because he had great possessions. That guy would match a bunch of us if that was the message for today. You see, there's a joy in forgiveness that religion can't provide. In fact, there's a joy in forgiveness that religion masks, seeks to duplicate, and in so doing, destroys. Let me show you what religion does. Come back with me to Genesis chapter 4. You want to see religion? Here's religion. Here's the first religious guy in the Bible. Jesus Christ in Matthew 23, talking to the Pharisees of his day, the religious leaders of the nation Israel, the only religion God ever gave in human history, gave to the nation Israel through the hands of Moses. And these people in Matthew 23, the Pharisees and the scribes, were the leaders of that religion. And he says, woe to you, Pharisees, woe to you, scribes. You've turned that religion on its head. And he talks to them about all the righteous blood of the martyrs, from Abel to Zechariah, the first guy killed in the Old Testament, the last guy killed in the Old Testament, all the righteous blood, which you have slain. Now think about that. If the Pharisees, when he says, you have slain, he talks about Abel, did anybody Jesus talking to kill Abel? No, they weren't there. What does he mean when he says you? He's not talking about the individuals, he's talking about you Pharisees. Well, who killed Abel? Cain. So what would that make Cain? He would literally be the first Pharisee, according to what Christ is saying. If the Pharisees are guilty of the blood of Abel all the way to Zechariah, you know what? There's a whole bunch of... What he's saying is there's a religious system been around that you guys have been captured by. And it starts with in Genesis 4. The first few chapters of the book of Genesis are there as a template for what happens when you turn your back on the Word of God. We've been over Genesis 3 many times and seen how that here is how sin tempts, how it attacks as it attacked Eve. And here are the sinful responses that our old sin nature authors, in order to shift the blame and get out from under the repercussions of the guilt of our sin. When you come to Genesis 4, you see religion developed. Here's Operation Fig Leaf that he learned from his mom and dad. Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have gotten a man from the Lord. Now I want you to notice what's on her mind when that baby's born. If you go back to chapter 3, verse 15, you'll see. God, when he curses Satan, he says, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. The woman is promised, or mankind is promised, a redeemer, a deliverer from the oppression of Satan. And it's going to be the seed of the woman. So when Eve has that first child, she says, here's the man God promised us. Here's the redeemer that God sent to us. And she thinks this is God fulfilling his promise. He gave us this boy. And what's on her mind is the issue of God fulfilling his... In other words, she's got the Lord. She's got some religion on her mind, some righteous thinking. And she again bare his brother, Abel. Now, you know there's some time involved in that. And Abel was a keeper of the sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. I read that and I think that's interesting. Because Cain, what did Adam do for a living? God said, go out and you're going to earn your keep by the sweat of your face. You're going to till the ground. Adam was a ground tiller. He was a farmer. You go over in David's day. You remember King David when he was a boy? He's tending the sheep out on the hills. That's where you put the rejects. That's where you put the ones you weren't concerned about. You know what they did when they had Cain? They said, here's God's man. Brought him into the family. He's sitting there in the family's business. He's got daddy's business. He's in the same. When Abel came along, they just kind of shunted him aside. And in the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit of the ground an offering unto the Lord. There came a point in time. They knew when to bring it. They knew where to bring it, and they knew what to bring. By the way. They knew how to worship God. Adam had walked in the cool of the day with God. When they sinned, God himself took an innocent animal and slew that animal and put the clothing on Adam. The only creature God had made that didn't have its own clothing was man. God clothed them with a garment of light, a coat of many colors, many colored light, that rainbow that you see in Ezekiel 1, Revelation 4, about the light that comes off the throne of God. And they literally wore the uniform of God as his representative. But when they sinned, that light was gone, that connection was gone, and they were naked. And God took an innocent animal and shed its blood, you know what that's a picture of now, and clothed them with the life of another. They knew about that. Cain comes along, and I don't know if you, when you read that verse, I know I'm reading between the lines, but you know how you think about things. In the process of time, it came to pass that Cain brought of the fruit an offering. I mean, you can see this guy out here. He's performing it. He's getting ready. Here's the great day, and old Cain's coming in with his offering from the fruit of the ground, the things that he's produced. God gave life to the ground, and I've tilled the things God gave me, and I've brought forth this great fruit, and I'm bringing it up here. And when he brought it, I'm sure he didn't just, I got something for you, Lord. This is a big production. We're bringing an offering to the Lord. I'm going to bring this offering, and the Lord's going to say, you're the guy that's going to redeem mankind. And go whip that adversary out there. Great expectations. While he's on the way, Abel watches him go and says, oh, you know, we're supposed to worship on this day. And Abel also brought the firstlings of his flock and of the fat thereof. You know what Abel did? He said, well, what the Lord wants is the blood of that lamb and the fat that belongs to him. So Abel went and got what God wanted, and he brought what God said to bring. And I don't know about you, but in my mind, here we got this big, you got this big ceremony going on. Everybody's watching. By the way, Adam and Eve had many sons and daughters, not just Cain and Abel. Had a lot of others. Genesis chapter 5 says they had many. Population of the earth was more than just four people at this time. And these guys are grown by now. Time's gone along here. And they've got this ceremony going on. And the religious system is being developed where we're going to go and worship God and give him the things that we do, and he's going to accept us and he's going to anoint us. And then here's Abel bringing up over here. I don't know if you've ever been around animals that are slain, killed, rendering plants. They're not the most odoriferous places that you'd want to be. They're not pleasing. In fact, they pretty much draw flies. But if you've got a big truckload of vegetables, that's a little different kind of, the whole scenario is different. Here's this great thing, desire. Although there, it's put it aside. The pomp, the ceremony that mom and dad have, here's going to be our Redeemer, going to save us. And he offers it, puts it on the altar. Abel walks over and he puts his on the altar. And when it says God had respect to Abel and his offering, but unto Cain and his offering, he had not respect. You go to the book of Leviticus and you read about how God did that. They put the offering on the altar, and the fire that was to burn that burnt offering could come from only one place. It had to come from the fire that God himself had ignited. When they opened the tabernacle with Aaron and his boys, two of Aaron's boys in Leviticus 10, they decided, well, God had told them, Leviticus 9, he told them, said, only the fire that comes off that altar can light these things. They decided, well, we just got, you know, it's too much trouble to do that. We get our Bic lighter out and go light it ourselves. And Nadab and Abihu were killed. God slew them. Read it in Leviticus 10. Killed them outright. Why? They offered strange fire that God didn't start. Elijah on Mount Carmel. Prays that God would accept the sacrifices. You remember the contest between the prophets of Baal and God? And how were they to accept it? Fire would fall out of heaven, boom, and ignite that fire, that sacrifice. God would accept it by consuming it with fire. So as they wait for God to accept the sacrifice, the fire comes and accepts Abel. And Cain just sits there. One guy's been accepted, not based on what he's doing, not based on his family's expectations of him, not based upon the pomp and the ceremony and the glory around him, just because he brought what God said to bring. He's accepted. The other guy, in all of his goodness and all of his righteousness and all of his works and all of his help and all the things he's going to do, he's working Operation Fig Leaf. Fig Leaf is what you get out of the ground, folks. And he says, look, if you're going to cover yourself with fig leaves, and that's a good idea, got that idea from his daddy, maybe a whole slew of a farm product would help more. And God ignores it. And look what Cain does. Cain was very wroth. Now that's not Brother Stridham saying wrath. You've heard Des say wroth, you know. That's sort of the way it is, but that's wrath, but it's not just wrath, it's wrath. This dude's mad. He's angry. He's offended. And his countenance fell. Now, that doesn't mean his face fell off his head. That means he turned his smile upside down, folks. This dude's he got mad. All the joy, the happiness that he's expecting, all the acclaim he thought he was going to get evaporated. And he turned into an angry, bitter, murderous character. And you know the rest of the story. He winds up murdering his brother. Sin leads to guilt and depression. And religion just further exacerbates the guilt and the depression, and it only complicates matters and leads to greater guilt and greater despondency. Listen, guilt, depression, those are emotions. Those are the opposite of joy and blessed. What does forgiveness do? It gives you the joy. Rejoice in the Lord. It gives you the love, joy, peace. Fruit of the Spirit, folks. Focus on the reality of who we are in Christ producing in our life something very wonderful. It's religion. It's self-performance. Now it's important, come with me to Genesis 27. It's important to understand this thing about feelings and operating on emotions. Because sometimes we get the idea that you shouldn't have any emotions at all. And if you shouldn't, then God made a mistake when he made you because he made you with them. I tell people all the time, if you take the word emotion and take the word, the E off of it, what do you have? Motion. See that? Emotions are designed to put you into motion. They are designed to be enablers of activity in your life. They are a part of your inner man, a part of your soul. They have a corresponding part in your physical anatomy, like your inner man has a part in your outer man. Something happens and you get all excited or you get scared, you get all this adrenaline pumped into your blood and you have to go walk around the block two or three times to get the adrenaline out, you know, because you can't. That's part of your physical emotions. But that comes from an internal process. No emotion is good or bad in itself. Somebody says, well, you shouldn't be angry. Paul said, be angry and sin not. If you couldn't get mad about the right things and have some righteous indignation, you wouldn't, I mean, if you can't get mad about what you ought to get mad about, you're not worth spit. I mean, what good is it? It's a motivator. But getting mad about the wrong things, focusing on the wrong things, that's the problem with fear. There are some things you ought to be afraid of. Somebody, you know, one time we were sitting here in this room on a Sunday morning, and the fire alarm went off. Some of you remember that. You know me, I think kids pulled the thing. I never believe those things. Turned out there was a fire. You know what? Fear says, get out. That's probably a good thing. I was in a hotel one night, Bible conference out there at Judson. Fire alarm went off. My wife, everybody's getting out. I told my wife, I said, just the kids in the hall. I got in the bed, going to go to sleep. I was the second to the last person out of the burning hotel. Nobody, they don't come get me. They don't come back. I go to the door, open the door, and the smoke comes all in. I said, oh, well, it must be real. I better get out. I'm on the seventh floor. And I'm going down, and the fireman, he says, are you Jordan? I said, yes, sir. He says, all right, we got him. Well, you know, a little healthy fear is a good thing. But it can also immobilize you. And you see, it's the habit of your old sin nature to use your emotions to immobilize you. That's when emotions get to be a problem, is when they sit upon the throne of your will and run your life. But you have to be very careful about these things because you have to operate on the basis of truth. If you operate on the basis of emotional revolt, where your emotions are in revolt, how do they get that way? When you take action based on the way you feel about something, your feelings are running your life, and you wind up in complete revolt and turmoil. When your mind is programmed by error, it produces emotions and desires based upon error. And that results in a corresponding action that comes out of the error. If your mind is renewed by the Spirit, by the Word of God, by the truth of God, and your mind is programmed with truth, with the facts of who God says you are, then you're going to take actions by faith in that truth that results in emotions that support the actions. But you see, the problem is you have the thinking that produces emotions that produce the action. That'll get you in trouble. Because what's producing the action? The emotion. If you have thinking that by faith you execute the action based on, listen, what happens then? The action produces fruit, one of which is emotion. You remember Romans chapter 6? Know you not? Fact. Don't you know? Reckon. There's faith. And what happens when you have your faith based in facts? You'll have fruit. Yield your members as instruments of righteousness. And when you yield yourself as an instrument of righteousness and you get out and start bearing the fruit of the Spirit, one of the fruits of the Spirit is love. One is joy. You see, that comes as a result of being who you are and living that out. I've said to you many times, your emotions are kind of dumb. They act in the way you think. That's the way they're designed to act. So what you want to do is have your life programmed by truth. Choose to do what you do in life. Take actions that you take based upon the truth of God's Word. And then the emotions come along and support it. And if they don't at the moment, so what? You still did what was right. And sometimes your emotions go kicking and screaming. They don't want to go because you've allowed them to sit on the throne. And you know what a little spoiled brat does first time you start making him behave? You know. Years ago, I was in a grocery in a department store. And there was a little kid just pitching a hiney fit. Wouldn't do anything his mother said. Pitching and screaming and hollering. And I still had young children. You get older, you forget how to deal with them. You get grandkids, you don't deal with them this way. And I went over to that little boy, and I sat down next to him. And I talked to him for about 15, 20 seconds. And I got up, and he went over and stood by his mama, and didn't say another word. A little while later, his mama came to me, and she said, Mister, I don't know you, and I don't know what you said to my son, but I'd sure like to know, because he sure started behaving. I said, well, I don't know if I should tell you or not. She said, I won't get mad at you. I said, okay, I'll tell you what I told him. I said, little boy, you're not going to mistreat your mother like that. You do that again, I'm going to take you out in the bathroom, and I'm going to blister your little rear end till it's red. And if you don't believe I'll do it, you see that little boy standing right over there? That's my boy. Go ask him. Now, I shouldn't be putting this out on the internet. That was many, many years ago. But you know, that's how your emotions do that. Because they're not in control. You're designed to reign in life by one, even Jesus Christ. He says, come, sit upon the throne with me, and let's reign in life. Not your emotions. Your will, submissive to God's will. Your faith, resting in an understanding of who God has made you in Jesus Christ. That's the way your life is designed to function. And sometime you'll go, and your emotions will say, I'm not going to go. You say, okay, we're going anyway. And sometime they'll get on the back seat of the car, and they'll go, and you just say, okay, if you want to sit there and have a hiney fit, waste your time, but we're going. And you know what? You go. And if you have to go with your emotions kicking and screaming and not wanting to go, go anyway. And the next time you get up to go, you know what? Your emotions will say, I don't want to go. And you say, we're going to go anyway. And sooner or later, your emotions will look at it and say, well, I guess he's going to go. We might as well go with him, but we don't have to have a good time. And you just keep going. And eventually your emotions will look at each other and they'll say, you know, oh, well, he's going to go. And, you know, he seems to have a good time when he goes. Maybe if we go and relax a little bit, we might have a good time. And before it's over with, 9 times out of 10, your emotions will come along and support the actions of your will. And if they don't, so what? You still did what's right. Genesis 27, is the classic illustration of a man operating on his feelings. Jacob is about, he's preparing to die. He says in verse 2 of Genesis 27, behold now, I am old, I know not the day of my death. Now he lived a long time after this, he's just getting a little introspective here. And so he wants to get his boys, Jacob and Esau, together, and he wants to bless them and pass the Abrahamic blessing on, which he's going to do in this call that Esau was the oldest. He's supposed to be the one that gets the blessing, but he had sold it to Jacob. You remember that? Rebekah knows that, so Isaac didn't know that. Isaac's fixing to bless Jacob. Esau. So Rebekah's going to help God out. Verse 20. Verse 15, Rebekah took goodly raiment of her elder son Esau, and which were with her in the house, and put them upon Jacob, her younger son. And she put the skins of the kids of the goats upon his hands and upon the smooth of his neck. And she gave the savory meat and the bread which she had prepared into the hand of her son Jacob. Now Esau was a ruddy field man. Jacob was sort of the houseboy wimp. Okay? So she's going to make Jacob look like and smell like Esau. Feel like him. Verse 18. And he came unto his father and said, Father, my father. And he said, here am I. Who art thou, my son? And Jacob said unto his father, I am Esau, thy firstborn. Liar, liar, pants on fire. But he's going to deceive him. I have done according to that as thou baddest me. Arise, I pray thee, sit and eat of my venison, and thy soul may bless me, that thy soul may bless me. And Isaac said unto his son, how is it that thou hast found it so quickly, my son? Red flag. Boy, you got that deer in a hurry, boy. How'd you do that? And he said, because the Lord thy God brought it to me. God was working in my behalf. And Isaac said unto Jacob, come near, I pray thee, that I may feel thee, my son, whether thou be my son, my very son Esau or not. And Jacob went near unto Isaac his father, and he felt him. And he said, the voice is Jacob's, but the hands are the hands of Esau. And he discerned him not, because his hands were hairy as his brother Esau's hands, so he blessed him. And he said, art thou my very son Esau? And he said, I am. And he said, bring it near to me, and I will eat of my son's venison, and that my soul may bless thee. And he brought it near him, and he did eat, and he brought him wine, and he drank. And his father Isaac said unto him, come near now, and kiss me, my son. And he came near and kissed him, and he smelled the smell of his raiment, and blessed him, and said, see, the smell of my son is the smell of a field which the Lord hath blessed. And he goes on and blesses him. How did Jacob and his mama deceive Isaac? Touch, smell, feel. His mind said, that's not your right voice. His thinking said, it's too soon. You couldn't have killed that deer that fast, brought it back in, had it ready to eat. His thinking didn't govern him. They used the feelings to deceive him. And that's why you have to be very careful. That's the classic example of a mistake based on going on your feelings alone. But understand, that doesn't mean you don't have feelings to go on. Or maybe I should say feelings that go with you, that are the result of the godly choices that you make. Come back with me to Colossians, if you will. When we're talking about this particular area, the blessedness of the man to whom God doesn't impute sin, when we're talking about the love, the joy, the peace, the long-suffering, we're talking about appropriating into your experience the reality of what God has given you in your position in Christ. You have an identity in Christ. You are redeemed. You are forgiven. God has taken your sin and set you free. He's taken the guilt and sent it to Calvary. He said, I'll remember it no more. I'll not connect it back with your identity again. I'll do it permanently and forever. You never have to come and ask me to accept you. I already have. You never have to come and say, please forgive me my sin. I already have. I've made you complete. I've blessed you with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Now, all I want you to do is take what I've already given you and bring it into the experience of your life on a daily basis. Colossians 2:10, it's over my head. And you're complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. But now look at chapter 4, verse 12. Epaphras, who is one of you, a servant of Christ, saluteth you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. Wait a minute, I thought they were complete. Then why is Epaphras praying and laboring that they would be complete? Okay? He says in Ephesians 1, you're accepted in the beloved. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he says, wherefore we labor, whether absent, present, or absent, we may be accepted of him. He said, wait a minute, I thought I was accepted. That's the difference between your standing and your state. Your position in Christ and your practice in time. Your identity in him, and then that identity living in your experience now. Now, you understand that. All you have to do, if you're complete in him, there's nothing to make you more complete. All you need to do is appropriate the completeness that you already have. Bring it into your experience. Have the practical, experiential possession of what already belongs to you. That is to experience the joy of I am forgiven. That's a wonderful thing. Let that inform your mind so that your emotions know how to relate to reality. Now, there are two things you have to have to appropriate anything. One, you got to know about it. You got to see what you already have in Christ. That's why in our meetings, I try to teach about that constantly. And I tell you, it's not so you be different from somebody else. I don't care about what the... I just want you to know who you are. That's why we rightly divide the word, so we know we're not Israel. We know we're the body of Christ. We know where to go in the Bible to find out who we are. Now, we enjoy studying everybody's information, but we don't think we are everybody. We know how to find out who we are. The key to the Christian life is knowing your identity. And you could never know your identity if you don't study the Bible rightly divided. Dispensational Bible study is the most practical thing you'll ever have in your life because it gives you the ability to know who you really are. But once you begin to know that's where my information is and that's the part of the Bible that's about me, that isn't enough. A lot of people think, whoo, okay, and they go live in some other identity. God wants you to take who he says you are and then appropriate an understanding of it. Get a grip on the riches that are yours in Christ Jesus. On the reality, the literal reality of your current identity at this moment in Christ. Complete, totally accepted, completely redeemed. I mean, whoa. Now, if that doesn't excite you, Paul says, not for that we have dominion over your faith, but we're helpers together of your joy. For by faith you stand. Is your faith resting in an understanding of who you are? But the other component is you not only have to know it, you have to be aware of your need of it. Because you'll never reach out and appropriate into your experience something unless you know that you really need it. That's what's happening to Paul in Romans 7. He'll say, Romans 7, oh, wretched man that I am, who should deliver me from the body? And you say, what? How do you get out of Romans 6 into that so fast? Romans 7:14, he says, I'm carnal, sold under sin. You lying rascal, you just told me that you're complete in Christ, you're dead with him, buried with him, raised with him. Chapter 6, how'd you get out of chapter 6 so fast? Paul in Romans 7 is not identifying himself as God does. He slipped back into identifying himself as he identified himself. Now he said it in one little phrase in Galatians 2:20, it's not I, but Christ. You got to have those it's not I moments where you become aware of your bankruptcy so that the riches of Christ become the thing that's the need of your heart. Appropriating into your experience is closed to all but the needy heart. It's available only to those who will say it's not I, but Christ. And with those two things, a conscious awareness of faith, trust in who you are, and then a realization of your absolute need in every moment for it, it's not I, it's Christ, then you need a lifetime of spiritual growth. Because, friends, it takes time for the Holy Spirit to work that process into the details of your life. That's why Romans 7 is in Romans 7, not 2, not 5. You've experienced it. You get on the mountaintop, and you know, I got the joy, 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 and then a little while later you're down here in the doldrums, and you say, I don't think I'll ever see the mountain again for the clouds. And when you're in those moments of need, rather than being mad at God or someone else, that's the moment to say, you know, here's a not I experience. I'm down here because I've been trusting me. And instead of defining your situation by your problems, define them by who you are in Christ, and look at the situation you've gotten into as an opportunity to grow, because that's exactly what God's grace has turned it into. While we were at the meeting in Tennessee, a young lady, her parents are missionaries in Asia, coming to the conference, had a car wreck, terrible accident, was injured quite severely, had a limb amputated. The word came to the meeting and people were talking about it. People were sending word, we're praying for her, and we're praying that this had happened, that had happened, the other happened, and why did God let this happen to her? And, you know, here's a young lady, parents serving the Lord, she's coming to Bible conference. Why would God let that? You know why that happened? Because she lives in a world where things like that happens. It happened to her because she had a car wreck. God didn't do that. I know there's a lot of pagan religion that says he did, but God didn't do that. You say, well, why does she hurt so bad? Because she was in a car wreck. She's in a body of flesh that hurts when you're in a car wreck. What did God do? God gave her something in her inner man that gave her joy, gives her joy in spite of all those bumps in the road. It's according to the riches of his grace. You see, you can feel forgiven even when the circumstances don't make out like you ought to. But you got to remember, no believer ever fell into maturity overnight. This is a lifelong process of spiritual growth, of learning over and over, it's not I, but Christ. And you take little boy steps, little baby steps at first, and then you become a person that can walk. Then you begin to, but it's always not I, but Christ. It's always seeing who I have, seeing the riches that are mine in him, and becoming aware of my need of that. Seeing and needing brings us from a childish meandering around to a responsible, specific walk of faith. It's called maturity. It's called being an adult. And Paul says he's predestinated us to the adoption of children. God desires adults for children. And he brings us to that maturity day by day. As we see, it's not I, it's Christ. And our redemption and forgiveness is according to the riches of his grace that produces that. Wherever you are today in your life, top of the mountain, bottom of the valley, somewhere in between, it's not I, but Christ is the key. Wherever you are today, it'll be different tomorrow. Not I, but Christ will be the key. And there'll be an opportunity there for you to grow in spiritual wisdom and maturity that lets the Lord Jesus Christ's life be what manifests itself in your actions and your attitudes. And you have the grand privilege of demonstrating to others how much you value and cherish him and how cherishable he is. Father, we thank you this morning for our life in Christ Jesus. We thank you for the privilege of being yours. And I pray that these things might sink into our hearts and bear fruit for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. We're going to sing number 60.